Well, good afternoon. Extremely nice to be here in Birmingham today. And I want to thank Chris. Can you hear me at the back? We were having a conversation earlier and we didn't realise the mic was on, so I assume you can. Anyway, I really want to thank Chris for the invitation. It was really appreciated. So I'm going to talk for about 15, 20 minutes about our research project, which was carried out in Birmingham and London. And I suspect that's one of the, using the word in a better way, it was one of the reasons Chris invited me. Now, I'm going to try and begin by explaining the rationale for why we wanted to do this comparison of Irish experiences between the 1970s and 1990s as being members of communities who was perceived as suspect, with those of Muslims in the 2000s and their perceptions of being suspected, of being members of a suspect community. And so I'm doing a little bit of history to begin with to try and explain the backdrop of why we came to do the comparison, and also to reinforce some of the historical comparisons I think there are, as well as the much more recent ones which the research was primarily about. So the backdrop was an awareness of the legacy of the historic Protestant and Catholic divisions in Europe and North America, and the context, and particularly as they played out in what we now know as the United Kingdom. And we thought that provided a relevant context for understanding the depth and breadth of contemporary hostilities by many towards Muslims. And religion has obviously been for centuries a crucial cleavage in Europe, in particularly in relation to immigration. In the current period, Islam is a sort of metonym for the dangers that those most opposed to immigration perceive as looming ahead. And, you know, one of the key aspects of those fears is loss of cultural identity or dilution of national identity. In the second half of the 19th century in Britain, Roman Catholicism represented a similar threat to the cultural nation as Islam is deemed to or perceived to be now. And working class Irish immigrants embodied the threat, as do people of Muslim appearance these days. And in each case, perceptions and fears about immigration, ethnicity and religion were intertwined. And indeed, that was a period when women also were particularly subject to harassment, because there are many instances of nuns being, convents being set fire to, nuns being chased, nuns being attacked in the second half of the 19th century. So that in a way was a sort of backdrop. And of course, one of the reasons they were attacked was because they were very visibly different in their dress compared with other Catholics. And so they were targeted. Now, I'm also going even further back, because I want to comment on the fact that in 15 days' times, many people, not all, certainly not including myself, will be celebrating Guy Fawkes Day on the 5th of November. And obviously, these days, it's pretty shorn of, for many people, of its cultural historical legacy. I won't be celebrating it because I was brought up in an Irish Catholic family in this country, and the idea that you'd celebrate such an anti-Catholic impulse would be completely foreign to us. So, I'll just skip on here. So, obviously, the gunpowder plot and its failure, which is what is celebrated on Guy Fawkes Day, and up until relatively recently, the guy was always the Pope, being burnt in effigy, and that still happens in Lewes in Sussex every year and a few other places, that it's always an effigy of the current Pope. The gunpowder plot was a plan to blow up the Houses of Parliament and instigate a rising to protest the tyranny they felt Catholics had to endure. And this was after James VI of Scotland and James I of England had taken over after Elizabeth and Mary Tudor before her, who'd instigated various persecutions of Catholics and Protestants respectively. So they felt the promises of toleration had not been delivered. So the plot was discovered, Guy Fawkes was arrested and tortured, and he and others were hung, drawn and quartered. And that's the story. But I want to give you this quote from, I don't know if any of you have heard of a lawyer called Clive Stafford Smith. He's represented many of the prisoners who are in Guantanamo. And he made this comparison where he went back to the gunpowder plot and what and the response to it and what that represented and how he saw parallels in the development of Guantanamo. So I'll just read it as it's there on the screen. As with Guantanamo Bay today, their goal, they being the king and the Privy Council, who had to issue a warrant before torture could be issued, carried out, their goal was not really to identify the plotters because the ringleaders had all been captured and killed within a few days. The goal was to get the evidence against, to get evidence against others whom the government suspected of involvement. In this, the rack, a means of torture, was successful. Some of Guy Fawkes' colleagues cracked and fingered the Jesuit priests. The authorities naturally believed that the priests were the ringleaders of any Catholic troublemaking. They were the imams of their day. Sadly, history teaches us that the wretched priests were probably innocent. Their limited knowledge of the plot had been learned under the veil of the confessional, and they had tried to steer Fawkes and his colleagues onto another course. Even though they were strong critics of Protestant intolerance, they knew then what the overwhelming majority of Muslims know now, that a violent plot by a few extremists would only lead to greater persecution against all members of their faith. But the priests were duly dispatched to the stake. Now, our research on suspect communities, or communities that are perceived as suspect, is the best way of putting it, was also really driven by being aware that the experiences of many Irish immigrants and their families in between the 1970s and 1990s were rather similar, we thought, with that of Muslims in the 2000s. And to be honest, I really had the idea to do the research because one day I was waking up a bit drowsy and I was listening to an interview on Radio 4's Today programme with a young man, Birmingham, who had been arrested about a week before at dawn with people crashing into his house. And to be honest, as I listened to it, I just thought, ooh, just like the 1970s and what was carried out then. So in that drowsy moment was really born the seed of trying to do this research. In particular, we were struck by the line the government sought to draw after 11th of September 2001 between Irish Republican violence and that they perceived as instigated by extreme Islamism. So let's move on here. Here's a quote from Tony Blair in the early 2000s. I've got a couple by him. He's very useful for quotes. So this is his statement. Terrorism is wrong, full stop. I think it is wrong, the killing of civilians, and what I'm about to say does not in any way mitigate against what I just said. I totally condemn the IRA terrorism that there has been over the past decades, but I don't think you can compare the political demands of republicanism with the political demands of this terrorist ideology we are now facing. Now, all I can say I expect that was quite news to quite a lot of Irish Republicans. Because up until that point, quite other discourses had contextualised Irish Republican violence, be it in Northern Ireland or in England. I don't think there was any incident in Scotland or Wales. And so let's just go back and compare. So here we have 1974, immediately after the Birmingham pub bombings, when 21 people were killed, compared with comments immediately after the tube and bus bombings on the 7th of July 2005. So we have Lord Hailsham back in 74 saying, for example, this is a war we have to win. Our duty is to wage it without sacrificing the ideals which make it worthwhile winning. So I think I've heard that quite a few times. And then after the tube bus bombings in London in 2005, this is John Reid, the Defence Secretary. I'm also sure that all of us will want to express our utter condemnation of those responsible for today's attacks. We must ensure that they understand that they will not win in their attempt to break our will or undermine our democratic response to today's events. So a lot of emphasis on winning. We also have, back in 1974, the Home Secretary of the day, Roy Jenkins, even at moments of shock and emotion, as great as that as the present time, it is important that we should remain rational and calm, because of course those are the characteristics of being British, and not respond too hastily. Then Charles Clarke, Home Secretary in 2005, the community as a whole, in my opinion, should seek to respond to these events in a calm and considered way. Or, my final comparison, Jenkins again in Hansard in November 1974, it is of great importance that we should recognise how utterly alien and repugnant to the overwhelming majority of the Irish is what is being done by a few totally unrepresentative fringe figures of their community, but he's placing them immediately within the community. And then we've got Blair, 2005, Muslims, like all of us, abhor terrorism. Like all of us, are its victims. And what's the end result of this? The end result of these constant juxtapositions in the press, in policy documents, in politicians' rhetoric, of contrasting the innocent Irish or the moderate Muslims with terrorists or extremists effectively leads the Irish and Muslim communities to be constructed as a two-faced Janus, with the law-abiding always defined in relation to extremists. Irish in the recent past and Muslim communities now simultaneously and ambiguously depicted in public discourses as victims, allies and suspects, and the boundaries between the three are shifting and permeable. I think that last point goes straight to a point made by a young scholar this morning who was talking about, do events like this push Muslims and the issue of terrorism together, or do they lead to a route out, as Liam Byrne was trying to advocate? It's a moot point, is what I would say, a very moot point. So how do we define a suspect community? We operationalised in our research the concept produced by Paddy Hilliard, who wrote a book called Suspect Community, published in 1993, about the experience of Irish people during the era of the IRA bombing campaigns and under the impact of the Prevention of Terrorism Act, which was brought in after the Birmingham pub bombings in 1974. And it just became the Terrorism Act in the year 2000. And most of the organisations that are prescribed under the Terrorism Acts and subsequent are all Irish or Muslim organisations to this day. So his definition was, a person who's drawn into the criminal justice system under the PTA, Prevention of Terrorism Act, is not a suspect in the normal sense of the word. In other words, they are not believed to be involved in or guilty of some illegal act. People are suspect primarily because they are Irish, and once they are in the police station, they are often labelled an Irish suspect, presumably as part of some classification system. In practice, they're being held because they belong to a suspect community. A slightly different definition is given by an academic who's written a lot in this area, called Marie Breen-Smith, and she gives this definition of a suspect community. A suspect community can be conceptualised as the product of the securitised mindset, rather than located in an embodied community or in a set of legislative and security practices. In other words, the suspect community, you'll see I always write it in quotes, is constructed in the imagined fears of those who see themselves as non-members of that community. Under this perspective, someone like Jean-Paul de Menez, who was killed, as you know, on a tube not long after the bombings in 2005, is part of the suspect community because of the assumptions made by his killers, who went on the tube and killed him. There's subtle differences between those definitions, really, and you'll see that in our research, most of the people we spoke to really thought you had to bring them together, not treat them as either or in terms of definitions. So in our research, we did a big media study of about 8 main papers between 74 and 2007. I'm not really going into that today, there's loads in that. We did equally a policy study from 74 to 2007. But what we also did in London and Birmingham was speak to key informants, community leaders and professionals who might have something to say about both eras of people being labelled suspect. And we also had mixed discussion groups, 4 in London, 3 in Birmingham, where we were really encouraging people, and there were no community activists of any type in these discussion groups. We just tried to contact people who lived in the cities throughout the periods and who had might have some experiences to share. And the reason we wanted that is because we were interested not to critique the prevent policy, although we were very critical of it. We really wanted to get at the story of everyday experiences of people in the way it impacted them. So, for example, what do you think of the idea of suspect communities, or how would you define it? We usually ask both questions. This is what people said. It stems from anti-terror legislation. It stems from government media branding, which really brings together both of those definitions I was looking at before, we were looking at before. And then people, and when I give these overarching comments, this is what came from the discussion groups and also the majority of the key informants, but particularly the discussion groups, where there was a lot of concurring about the salient main features of how counter-terrorism actions impact on people. So it involves conceiving a group as homogenous, and we've heard tons today about how all communities are diverse, obviously true. It involves watching a group, it involves fearing a group. And the result is a defensive community, a marginalized community, a fearful community. A little bit more comes about that later. So I'm just going to give you two examples of becoming aware that you're suspect when you didn't think you were suspect before, how it happened in everyday life. And this is a guy in he's talking about his workmates, and he lived in Birmingham. And like myself, about 5-6 years ago, I was working somewhere where I was the only Asian person there. And at the time, it was the Iraq War. So he told me this was about tail end of 2002, beginning of 2003, was about to start, and there was some discussion going on. It was about cricket or something, and it was about Pakistan losing. I wasn't from Pakistan anyway. I was trying to tell them I wasn't from there. I am an Arab. But to them, because of the ignorance, as you were speaking about, and the as you were speaking about is directed at the Irish people in the group, certainly not directed at me, they never even know what the difference was between an Arab and a Pakistani. So basically, anyway, the discussion went to Iraq, and then a person made the comment that when this war starts, we're going to get you and hang you. That's what they said to me. And I said, you're going to hang me? And they said, we're going to hang you. And I said, you and who? You know, because I was upset at the time. I think he was apologising for being rude. That he could make a statement like that. And I thought that growing up in this area, in this community, why is it suddenly it can just turn like that? The whole thing again. So I can see the similarities between us, to be honest. He was responding to a 78-year-old man, Irish man, who talked about what it had been like going to work in a factory in Birmingham the day after the Birmingham pub bombings, and that was the response this brought forward. Then this one, another how someone became aware, much shorter. This is a woman in London. I remember going to work one day, and one of the tenants downstairs, she called me coming out. What have I done wrong, you know? She said, put your arms out, and she was kind of going like searching. Then I realised what it was all about, you know, the devastation. It affects you, kind of. You know, lots of underlying remarks, and you just try and ignore them. That woman had never spoken to anybody outside her family of her experiences, and she said she'd been very scared just coming to the discussion group, even though it's 10 years after the Good Friday Agreement, when undoubtedly things had improved for many Irish people. So this was another broad category of questions. What is the impact of being perceived as part of a suspect community? And again, there was fair unanimity about this. So first of all, there's backlash. at work in public spaces, shunned at work in shops by friends on public transport, discrimination, mostly housing and jobs, policing, stop and search, raids, being watched, problems travelling, alienation due to the policing practices and to the general us and them attitude that was experienced. Adopting a low profile was quite a common response, especially of a lot of Irish people and definitely a lot of older Muslim people who took part. And some felt it was enforced upon them by constraints in public, lack of confidence, the skewed debate in the media, and others adopted it because they felt so fearful. And then, of course, there was resistance on street, in shops, at work, usually pursued by quite younger people. And in the discussions, it was very interesting that a lot of the Irish people who took part were in their 50s, 60s and 70s, and the vast majority of the Muslims who took part were in their 20s and 30s. But those Irish people had been their age when they were experiencing what happened in the 70s and 80s, and that became the bridge, the intergenerational bridge, as well as the inter-experience bridge. So differences. We're not in any way trying to say everything was similar. We do argue that the everyday experiences were remarkably similar from what people told us. But of course, the broader context is different. And here's one, actually a very well-known, but I won't say the name, civil liberties activist in London, who said the following on differences. I'm not saying there wasn't a racist element in the 1970s, but you know, but you are more markedly different. I mean, what I'm saying is, in the 1970s, you could probably lower your voice or not speak, which is not great for any human being, but you can probably do that and be smart and get out of trouble. And you can't, you know, lower your skin tone. That is an added dimension, I think, you know, that sometimes people forget. There's a lot in that statement. A, the assumption that all Muslims are identified by skin colour. B, the assumption that lowering your voice or not speaking is smart, as opposed to actually being quite an extremely constraining and demeaning experience, which is how many of the Irish women who talked about going into supermarkets and adopting that strategy but not liking it. Then you've got this, a second generation Irish key informant in Birmingham, who again is struggling to pin down what is different, and she comes out with this, which in many ways agrees with the civil liberties person in one way but not in another. In 74 it was fair game in factories and schools and services to racially abuse people. There was no legislation to protect people. But latterly there has been, that is a slight change in the two communities. Because I mean, I'm sure that Muslim people are verbally abused, but there is no legislation to protect people in the workplace and in schools. She means back then because the Race Relations Act, upon which all subsequent claims can be made, came in 1976, so 2 years after the Birmingham pub bombings. There was no kind of recourse, you know, an employee couldn't be disciplined for calling somebody an Irish whatever, murderer, murdering bastard in 1974. But latterly, if that would have happened, and you would hope that procedures would be followed. She's trying to struggle. I mean, both of them, in a way, are dealing with that trope that often is in people's heads, of almost a league table of victimhood. And I'm not sure that it really helps in either case. They're struggling to come up with what they think is relationship. And here I want to just end with this young Muslim professional in Birmingham, Guy, who I thought made a very perceptive comment, really perceptive comment, on as he saw it, on the differences. In terms of differences, yes, I think the Irish people probably had it hard because we haven't seen that. But when you look at our side, maybe they had it more harder than us because they were very much involved with the English community, with the British people, whereas the Muslim community are kind of a Muslim community itself. The only time they probably face our non-Muslim colleagues is probably at work, or if we go out to the area where we live. So we probably get it easier to a certain extent. So I think the Irish probably had it harder at some points, but then, if you look at the other points, maybe not as hard, because we don't just get attacked, because of the religion that we follow. It's also because of the colour and the racism issue comes into it. So I wanted to end with him because I think he's trying to straddle both and understand both and come at it both historically and as he perceives it. And obviously when he talks about the Muslim community, he was very much talking about his own experience. So to conclude, I mean, we had loads of conclusions, but I suppose one of the main ones was that despite protestations by politicians, the security agenda is often indivisible from the social cohesion agenda. And it's an utterly fatal bringing together of two policies, two strategies, two approaches. The social cohesion agenda, I think, again, despite protestations, is fairly inflexible in its requirements. It's okay, as well as national identity, to have, and we've heard a lot about it today, neighbourhood allegiances and city loyalties, and saying often, as we know, people can say, I'm a Brummie, or I'm a Londoner, or I'm a Scouser, because it gets around a lot of problems, especially if people are from immigrants themselves or from immigrant families, of getting round the issues of Britishness. But I think underpinning Britishness and its supposed enlightenment values is a politics of belonging, and I agree with the chair's comment after his paper, the politics of belonging that draws boundaries itself and is, they're often really iniquitous. And my view, it should be possible, if you're subscribing to Britishness, to have other allegiances, not only locally and city-wise, but you should be able to have diasporic allegiances that are recognised and valued in the same way as local ones. And it shouldn't be a threat to belonging in Britain that you might have very, very strong allegiances to the country you come from or the country your parents or grandparents came from. Because quite honestly, that's the steady state in a globalised world. And that is what migration is all about. And until that is recognised, there'll be no hope for the social cohesion agenda as currently construed. Thanks.